This is a panel to discuss the future, especially for this new EU strategy and EU programs, and to make it available and effective for local and regional strategies to fight against food waste. But the objective there is to exchange with policymakers at this level to identify the coming opportunities and the policy levers to activate and to enhance specific food waste action. So I will introduce the speakers, and then I will ask them specific questions following your presentation, Mr. Zambrisky. So we have first among the panelists, Mr. Vassilios Ampas, Vice Governor for Rural Development for the region of Western Macedonia. Welcome, sir. Then we have Mr. Jan Gulland from Scotland. Jan is the director of the Association of Cities and Regions for Sustainable Resource Management, based in Brussels. And we will have extra guests, but before they come in, I suggest to start this panel with the speakers who are online at the moment. Following the presentation made by Mr. Zambrisky regarding the Farm to Fork strategy and its specific objectives regarding food waste, Mr. Ampas specifically, as regional policymaker, according to you, what are the main opportunities for you, for your region, from what you have heard regarding the new EU objectives for food waste reduction? The floor is yours. If you have a first comment, answer for this question, and I will come back to you for next question later on. Please, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a very interesting, the whole day has been very interesting, and I'm very glad that I'm here. Well, first of all, I have to admit that the regional policy has to be approved by the EU. So everything that is inside gives us the opportunity, let's say, to give it back to the European Union about what everything we try to do. I think that waste waste food is something that has to be done. Not, I think that the previous speaker was very quantitative about what is our goals, but I also think that maybe we should try to have more focused on the mitigation that there is a big problem in our country with the mitigation. So I think that if we manage to achieve less food waste, so it would be better if we could use it with the funds from mitigation or even with the European social policy. So we could earn more money, or we could have more projects about the food waste, about the economy of food waste, by using other funds, and also be able to use them for having more projects. In our operation program, development operation program, we had some projects about the food waste. No, we didn't have, we have only one project, but it was, let's say, specially focused on that. it wasn't there wasn't a big interest about food waste. Maybe let's say that after we have a new we could have the more objects on our strategy and have more goals on agriculture or in industry or in restaurants or in other if it would be more committed to one of these goals, it would be much better for our region. Our region, as the technical assistant, the project manager mentioned before, it's mostly an agricultural region. So maybe it would be better for us to have more focus on that sector. So I'm sure that the next programming period, we would deal more with that, going on agricultural sector.
Thank you, Mr. Rampas. I will introduce Mr. Josep Maria Tosti Boras, Director of the Waste Agency of Catalonia. Welcome, sir. I will give you the floor right now. I guess you heard the presentation from Mr. Zambreski about the ambitions of the Farm to Fork strategy, specifically its objective on food waste. What's your reaction first on that when you heard such a presentation, please?
Welcome, good afternoon for all. Thank you, dear colleagues, and thank you for all the participants in this project. It's very interesting, the last meeting. For me, my first impression is very good. I have confidence for these possible results, and we have opened to prepare projects with different actors, administrations, entrepreneurs, companies, public sector, and the other ONGs for this good challenge. Repeat, I have confidence with this opportunity to prepare. In Catalonia, we have old experience for the battle against the food waste. We open our work in 2011 when we have an analysis from the University of Barcelona. This analysis established our reality. In 2010 in Catalonia, we lost per people 35 kilos of waste. And this situation opened your eyes to need react to cut this situation. From 2011, we developed any projects from public, from private sector, from ONGs. We have a big work. And now, with a new opportunity, this big Green Deal, for us is a big opportunity. Now in Catalonia, we have the new food waste Catalan law, and now we prepare a new law of waste and resources. And with this, laws, we are ambitious to prepare projects and prepare a good projects with different members and use with clever this opportunity and this money.
Thank you, sir. I come back to Yann Gulland for the SCR Plus Association. Same question for you, Yann. What's your feeling, what's your reaction regarding the Farm to Fork strategy and specifically the food waste objectives for the next period, please? You have to unmute your mic. Okay.
Yeah, hi, thank you, sorry about that. And thanks for the opportunity to speak today on behalf of ACR Plus. Certainly we welcome what's been said. Absolutely delighted to see the connection between Farm to Fork strategy, the Green Deal, EU regional and social funds, seeing all of those things beginning to align is very positive. Clearly, we support the 50% target that was mentioned, the need for a consistent methodology in terms of measuring food waste and food losses. Clearly, the EU platform that, for food losses and food waste to continue is a really good idea, because ultimately we all need to collaborate across Europe and work together. We need to work out what works and also what doesn't work, so we can really accelerate, you know, the shift to reduce food for all the reasons that people have said, in terms of the particularly the climatic impact that food waste has, as well as all the other social and economic and health impacts with that. Our focus obviously would be to ensure that, you know, the action plan as it goes forward is a need to empower public and regional authorities to facilitate change and action on the ground. And I think there's four reasons for that. You know, clearly, as others have said, it's all about citizens and consumers, and, you know, that relationship that regional and municipalities have with their citizens is very key, it's very close. Second thing is obviously in terms of having local, understanding the local circumstances, the local culture, what will work, what might not work in terms of the local sets of circumstances. There's also this idea that local regional authorities will be able to pilot things, as we've seen today, lots of new initiatives. We have the scope to pilot things again to demonstrate that, you know, what works and what doesn't work. But also the fact that regional government can play in terms of long-term strategies, so we can actually set the framework that will allow, whether it's regulatory incentives, to really make change happen and embed it into society, particularly around behavioural change. So I think looking, you know, more broadly about the role that we'd like to see, a real focus on how regional and cities can play in taking this forward. And the other thing is the thing to be welcomed, that this is about everybody doing this. Everybody's involved. And, you know, I think the presentation really encompassed the fact that there's a whole range of stakeholders. I think certainly my background was food waste. When we, even 5 years ago, food waste was all about waste management, people dealing with food waste at the end of pipe. It is much more, it's matured now into a much broader church of participants from farm to fork, from agricultural sector right through the food supply chain, and everybody's now recognising that they have a role to play. So it's not just about recycling of food waste, it is ultimately about prevention, and we need to get that first and foremost. When we talk about food waste, it is about how do we prevent food waste in the first place. The only plea I would say in terms of funding is we really do need to think about how do we build capacity, particularly in those regional and municipal governments and assemblies, to actually take this forward, because this is about joining up different actors and getting everybody around the table. And I think there's a capacity issue if we really want to accelerate this. So how can we make sure those funds are not just there for the projects and the investments and the research, but how do we build capacity to really make this happen?
Thank you, Ian. Thank you indeed. We will come back on the specific aspect of your answers later on. I come back to Mr. Ambass regarding some parts of your answers a few minutes ago. It's clear that the climate issue is very central, is pivotal to justify this ambitious strategy for the farm-to-fork strategy, I would say. Mr. Ambass, you said that you would be happy to mobilize, to trigger again extra financial instruments like the European Social Fund. Could you please tell us a bit more about that? What for the European Social Fund regarding food waste in your region, please?
Well, first of all, I have to say that we have to calculate for food, let's say, the food miles. This is very important when we want to calculate the carbon footprint. So this is the thing that we have to admit that it plays a special role. So if we try to use that idea, that means that for the local economy, it is very crucial to have food on this area. But this is a main problem, because let's say that most of the food is going abroad. So if we manage to use food which is also produced with the ideal procedure, but it's not, let's say, A quality, that means that this food can be given to social policy. So this would this can give us the extra money from another fund about the waste food. So because it will not be something that will go for, let's say, much cheaper. This is my idea of using the European Social Fund.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Ambass. I welcome Mr. Guillaume Garot, a French member of the Parliament.
Hey.
Yeah, good afternoon, Mr. Garot. I will come back to you later during the panel session, because okay. You will introduce yourself and your work. The work you've done against food waste in France in French language. So for that reason, I apologize for the attendees and participants. But we have circulated the summary of your presentation in English this afternoon to all the participants. So all the participants can refer to this English summary. So I will come back to you later, Mr. Garot. Maybe at the end of this session for a longer introduction from your side. Okay, I come back to Mr. Zambrisky before you leave. Do you have from European Commission DG Santé, do you have any reaction before you leave?
I would say non-specific. I would like to thank speakers from RCR and from Catalonia. I can congratulate them, because as a waste person, I follow their developments on the link on first of waste biodegradable, waste composting, and now to turning into food waste. And I can personally confirm that since 2010, they are in the European lead on that part. So, well, so they say what I expect from the leaders. They confirm the strategy goes into that into right direction. Concerning ESF fund, I think at least I'm not aware of any direct of funds which are directly linked ESF and food waste. Of course, there is a funds under FAD. So the issue is to basically here FAD is a European fund for European aid to the most deprived, and this is one of the group of social funds, but it's separate from the European social funds. Where, of course, the issue to address here is mostly on the food donation of food banks, that it's much easier to give money to food bank to organize a food collection rather to buy a food directly from supermarket to most deprived, because otherwise we can have economy of scale and prevention of food waste. So, but I have to say that on specifically on social funds, I'm not yet aware of programs which would link this aspects directly with the prevention of food waste. But I guess some of that may be developing in future when we will be able better to integrate the various policies and find synergies between them. So yes, I think that that's all from me.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Zambriziki. I come back to our regional policymakers Mr. Josep Maria Tosti Boras in Catalonia. From your perspective, sir, do you think that something is gonna change thanks to this Farm to Fork strategy and ambitious targets on food waste for the coming period? If we enter into the programming machine, I would say, we talked about the ESF, the ERDF, the CAP, etc. Do you think this will be easier or a bit challenging to coordinate the various policy instruments in between? I just give you an example. We often said that regarding food losses is encapsulated within the CAP, the Common Agricultural Policy, and food waste on the other side is outside, is part of the regional policy, the ESF, etc., etc. So from your perspective, do you think it will be easier, or do you have any suggestion for the implementation of this new strategy? Please.
Thank you for all experience who participate in different projects in European level. For us, the most important question is the first important action is we need an harmonization about this question, because the question of food waste or food questions, they are in different instruction, in different documents. We need an unique criteria around Europe. It's necessary one organization of the regulation for the first important step, because there are different levels, but the food waste is not only agriculture question. This question is in all the fields: agriculture, food safety, fisheries, social affairs, or taxation. And we need the first question is harmonized the situation, because and for us, it's not need a new money, because they are money. Only the most important question is one alignment of existing policies. This is for us the main criteria, because they are for us the RDF or ARF-RDF. Now they include the food waste and a specific topic, but we need a clear harmonization for all the countries for the European level. Because the food question is a very important question. It's a main important question for us. But we need a clear rule for all, and a clear alignment with the Green Deal and the new circular economy strategy. But the main question is one alignment of around Europe of this regulation, because money and instruments now exist, and a very good experience.
Do you mean, sir, that you expect an alignment of the policy targets within each member state and also at regional level? What do you mean precisely by alignment?
For us, is the alignment is the food waste is a very important topic for the Commission, for the Parliament, for the member states, and offer capacity to regions to develop this role, because in all the policies, the food waste of these targets are important.
Thank you, sir. I come back to Maybe Jan Gulen, the same question I raised to the previous speaker. Do you have any comment on that?
So I can probably only speak from the Scottish perspective. I mean, I think that's what's changed. I think, as I said, food waste was very much kind of municipalities looking at the end of pipe. But the shift in, not just from the conversation that's now happening at EU level, but, you know, particularly around climate change, then everybody's now looking at food waste and food loss and the whole supply chain. So there is a distinct shift. So the Scottish Government have introduced a target. It's a 33% reduction target by 2025, created an action plan for food waste, which is then reached out into the kind of food loss area as well, with industry, the farming and production industry in Scotland. And there is a sense that everybody is now on the same page, looking at the same issues, and certainly collaborating more around the system approach, rather than seeing it as, well, that's your target and that's your target and you need to do something over there. I think that is what's changed dramatically, I'd probably say, even in the last year, 18 months, you are seeing, and I think the climate change agenda, I mean, Mr. Ambas mentioned about, carbon. There's been a lot of clear interest over the last 2 years on plastics. You know, consumers all over Europe are engaged around the plastic, issue. But when you certainly from a household point of view, the carbon recording that we've done suggests that the food waste impact from household waste is three times that of carbon, that of plastics. When you relate that to the public, it is a light bulb moment. They are very much engaged, and individuals, both within businesses and at home, are wanting to contribute to doing something about climate change. So engaging them around food waste, I think, is a great starting point for that. And they can take action at home and in businesses and on the farm and in the supply chain. And I think that has managed to align, all of those partners in the kind of common goal.
Thank you, Jan. I mentioned that Mr. Zamzicki is leaving. So thank you, Mr. Zamzicki, for your participation to this event. See you next time, I guess, regarding the next developments of the Farm to Fork strategy and the food waste commitments. Thank you, sir. If you agree, I come back to some specific Q&A from the participants on the right side. There is a question for Mr. Toast in Catalonia from Felicitas Schneider. Sir, I didn't get which legislation is already in force and in preparation in Catalonia. Could you please repeat or detail? Does or will this legislation target the whole food supply chain or specific stakeholders? Please, Mr. Toll.
Thank you for your question. It's very simple. In the last May, the Catalan Parliament approved the new law of food waste. It's a very ambitious law, and it covers all the entire food chain, from the farm to the consumer. And the next year is possible, I think, we approve a new law of waste and resources of Catalonia.
Okay. Thank you, sir. We have also a question regarding the food donation. I guess it was a question about a general question. We can consider that, it's a question from Elisabeth Mercier from France. We can consider that the level of prices of food products has an impact on the level of food waste, generally speaking. Higher are the prices, weaker is food waste. Food has value, so it could be logical to pay more with respect to nature, biodiversity, and high standards for animal welfare. In this prospect, we need a social policy for people who doesn't have enough money. Is it also an idea which was in mind from the previous speaker, for instance, from Mr. Ambas from Western Macedonia? Mr. Ambas, I give you the floor if you have some comments.
Let me read again the question because I'm not sure I realize the question.
The question is as follows. One can consider that the level of prices, of food prices, has an impact on the level of food waste. So the assumption is higher are the food prices, weaker is food waste. So food has value, so it could be logical to pay more in order to protect more the biodiversity and nature, etc. But in that respect, we would need a social policy for people who cannot afford food products. What do you think? Especially for the less deprived people, the people in need.
I'm not sure that this is what I meant, because what I'm trying to do is, let's say, for people who don't have enough money to have quite good food. But as I mentioned in the second time that I spoke, is I spoke about having a decrease of the food miles. Let's say this, if this could happen in a local area, and this means that they could have also very good quality of food. Let's say that some things that we know for sure in the Southern Europe is that the taste of the fruits or of the vegetables is much higher if you taste it when the fruit are mature. So this is much tastier, but this cannot be done because we need to transport and to give it, let's say, to some other countries. But this is also something that when can be used as an idea to have quality and more tasteful food for people on a local area.
Okay, so I understand that it relates to the other aspects introduced by Mr. Zamsiki regarding the world supply chain running at local or regional level. So the other component of the food farm-to-fork functionment, I would say, indeed. Okay. I come back to my range of question, if you agree again, because the very central part of this project, EcoWaste for Food, was the exchange of experience from regional perspectives across Europe, mm-hmm. So to facilitate a cross-pollination as well. But also, you may know that we heard a lot of testimonies today to trigger policy change at regional level. So to use the EU facilities, the EU programming facilities, I would say, in order to trigger policy change at regional level. So my question to each panelist at the moment, because some of you were part of, at least indirectly, were part of the EcoWaste for Food project as policymaker. For the new programming period, do you have an idea how you would articulate maybe differently your policy change objective according to the EU new ambitions and to the EU financing instruments, including ERDF, the role of the CAP, etc. In other words, if I can reframe this question, do you think that we have enough policy instruments to implement all these objectives in the end, given that, as Shen Ward told this morning, a lot of changes are in the end of the consumers, in the end, in the households. So how can we articulate this very high level and global agenda regarding the reduction of food waste and the need to change the behaviors at consumers and households levels? Do you have an idea, Mr. Toast in Catalonia? I don't know if I'm clear enough, but.
Okay, thank you. Well, for us, we want to adopt the knowledge of experience in this program and adopt this knowledge about the our new law. Because for us, our experience the last years of this program is very interesting, shared with another region and other authorities, specific targets, specific tips have developed in this new law. Because for us, the question of food waste is a very central question. In Catalonia, the 50% of our food is imported, and we need to protect this situation, protect the farmers, protect the values of the food. The problem in our modern societies in the last 40 years, we lost the values of the food, and we need recovery, and especially offer campaigns to the citizens to open their mind, or open their idea, and open and recover this important question of the food. And we want to adopt these lessons in our legislation, because the next year are very important. The Green Deal is about the circular economy, and the food waste is circular economy, and the food is the circular economy. And we only have confidence with this is the new law, we are aligned for the European policies.
Thank you. Before giving the floor to Guillaume Garot in few minutes, because it's also about national laws, I come back to Jan Gulen about this this question of circular economy. If I want to be short, many initiatives that have been implemented to reduce food waste have been organized under the framework of the paradigm of food donation and food redistribution. So to reach also social objectives. But do you think that now? And through this Green Deal, the Farm to Fork strategy, and the food waste objective raised before, we have enough possibilities to enter into a new phase where it's within the circular economy model, I would say, the food circular economy, but we will tackle the food waste issue.
So I think that the quick answer is we need to design that. I think quite a lot of the, certainly from my own experience, the food distribution networks that have been established have been out of need, you know, social need in terms of people who are less advantaged in society and people then, you know, donating food, which has been, you know, very purposeful and has a huge impact. But absolutely, we are now beginning to see beyond that, you know, people interested more about food sharing, particularly excess food from, obviously prior to COVID-19 happening, from restaurants, from bars, food at the end of being redistributed within communities. We ourselves in Scotland helped establish a food sharing hub in one of the cities in Edinburgh to do exactly that. So, I think that's where exactly Green Deal money or investment could really be put to good use, is designing that infrastructure. So not just to some extent waiting for it to kind of come up when there is a need, but actually deciding this is a tactic we want to deploy. And I think, you know, even experience from COVID-19, we set up a food sharing service between hospitality industries and suppliers. Suppliers who weren't getting access to their main markets to redistribute that food at a local level to the people in communities through smaller retail outlets. So we did that because the circumstances allowed us to do that at the time. But actually designing that from scratch as something, as infrastructure you would want, absolutely what we should be using Green Deal money for, not just, as I said, from the bottom up, designing that and layering that across cities, regions, municipalities, small villages, rural communities as well. I think that definitely is a way forward.
Thank you, Jan. Thank you for raising this COVID situation perspective indeed, and future needs regarding our own population for having access to food. Now, I suggest to give the floor to Guillaume Garot. Guillaume Garot is a member of the French Parliament, and he has been, a pioneer in Europe through the parliamentary report he carried out, and then the National Act Against Food Waste he has proposed to the National Parliament, the French Parliament, a few years ago. And now this law has entered into force. And I suggest Guillaume Garot give us an overview, because as said before by Mr. Tost, in Catalonia, indeed, Catalonia has voted a new law against food waste. But before Catalonia, indeed, France had already did it. And I think it's important to listen to your point, Guillaume Garot. What has been achieved from, 4 years ago, four years later. And I think we can learn from your feedback on that and what could be improved in the future. This could be interesting for extra European region. So you will tell us in French, okay? And everyone has received by email the summary in English, and then we will manage a Q&A session with you. It's your turn, Guillaume.
Thank you, Samuel. Sorry, I'm not fluent in English, so I prefer speak in French. Sorry, nobody's perfect. I am French. Merci d'abord à Samuel et merci de votre invitation. Moi, je suis très, très heureux d'assister à vos travaux cet après-midi, parce que c'est fondamental qu'à l'échelle de notre Union, nous puissions les uns les autres, différents acteurs, échanger, parler ensemble et tracer des perspectives pour la suite, pour en particulier les actions à mener tant au plan européen qu'à l'échelle de nos pays. Alors, beaucoup de choses ont été dites avant que je n'intervienne. Je vais redire les choses très simplement s'agissant de la stratégie Farm to Fork. D'abord, pour vous dire que moi, je me réjouis que la lutte contre le gaspillage alimentaire soit maintenant reconnue comme un objectif politique. Et que l'Union européenne se soit saisie du sujet avec des objectifs. Donc ça, c'est très important. Ce que je veux dire, néanmoins, c'est trois choses sur cette dimension européenne. La première, c'est que on doit travailler les uns les autres ensemble, quand je dis les uns les autres, les membres de l'Union européenne, pour qu'on puisse avoir une coordination, peut-être une harmonisation des actions publiques que nous engageons. Ça me paraît très important que, en déclinant, bien sûr, cette volonté politique européenne que je partage, il puisse y avoir cette coordination de l'action entre les États de l'Union, en tout cas ceux qui sont engagés dans une politique de réduction du gaspillage. Deuxième chose que je voudrais dire, c'est que la question de la mesure, de l'évaluation donc, du gaspillage, elle est, et vous l'avez dit, fondamentale. Il faut savoir de quoi on parle, et si on se fixe des objectifs chiffrés, il faut savoir d'où on part, c'est-à-dire comment on peut mesurer année après année, acteur après acteur, pays après pays, les progrès que nous réalisons contre le gaspillage alimentaire. Alors, il y avait un très beau travail qui a été conduit par l'Union européenne, c'était le programme Fusion, c'était il y a 8 ans maintenant, sept ans, qui a permis aux uns et aux autres de poser des jalons, c'est très important. Il y a une décision déléguée qui a été prise plus récemment, donc c'était en mai 2019. Très bien, on a des outils. Encore faut-il que les États suivent. Encore faut-il qu'on mette en œuvre à l'échelle de nos pays ce qui est aujourd'hui rendu possible, recommandé par l'Union européenne. Mais il est très important que la volonté politique sur la question de la mesure du gaspillage soit affirmée en permanence. Troisième chose que je voulais dire pour mettre en œuvre de façon efficace cette stratégie européenne, c'est l'idée qu'on doit généraliser les bonnes pratiques, travailler ensemble, voir ce qui se fait de bien d'un État à l'autre. Et là-dessus, on a beaucoup à apprendre les uns des autres. Vous savez, pour faire la loi que j'ai portée en 2016, donc j'étais député. J'ai d'abord été ministre de l'alimentation, de l'agroalimentaire en France, et j'avais à l'époque regardé ce qui se faisait d'intéressant sur le gaspillage dans certains de vos pays. Alors j'étais allé en Allemagne, j'étais allé en Grande-Bretagne, et j'avais été impressionné par la volonté, l'engagement de certains acteurs publics. Que ce soit des acteurs publics de l'État ou des acteurs publics de région, qui dépendent de l'organisation évidemment de chaque pays, contre le gaspillage. Et je pense qu'on aurait besoin aujourd'hui d'un vrai centre de ressources européen, d'une plateforme d'échange, comme l'est finalement EcoWaste for Food, mais de façon permanente, de telle sorte qu'on puisse vraiment s'appuyer les uns sur les autres, repérer ce qui va bien ici, ce qui va moins bien ailleurs, et qu'on puisse avancer dans le respect de ce que nous sommes et de nos différences, bien évidemment, mais avancer vraiment avec des choses, des actions très concrètes. Ça, c'est indispensable aussi qu'on puisse réussir ça. Alors, puisqu'on est toujours sur le plan qui n'est pas dans la note, mais que je voudrais évoquer devant vous, qui est la question des dates de consommation. Vous savez qu'il y a une liste de... vous me direz, c'est un détail. Je ne crois pas que ce soit un détail, parce que ça éclaire aussi ce que je viens de dire. Il y a la question des dates de consommation, qui est un levier ou un frein, tout dépend comment on le regarde, dans la lutte contre le gaspillage. Alors, je ne parle pas des produits frais soumis à une date limite de consommation parce que les prescriptions d'hygiène sont extrêmement strictes et il faut qu'elles le soient. Je parle davantage des produits qui sont soumis à une date de durabilité minimale. Les produits secs. Et vous savez qu'il y a une liste de produits qui ne sont pas soumis à des dates limites, en tout cas, ou des dates recommandées de consommation. Vous savez, le sucre, le sel ne sont pas soumis à ces recommandations de consommation. Quand vous achetez un kilo de sucre, il n'y a pas dessus la mention à consommer de préférence, best before, le 10 octobre 2020 ou octobre 2020. Moi, je propose qu'on puisse allonger la liste, compléter cette liste avec des produits qui ne seraient plus soumis à ces exigences de date de durabilité minimale parce qu'on sait qu'ils ont une durée de vie extrêmement longue. Alors, vous me direz, oh, mais ça, c'est un petit sujet, c'est un petit levier. Je serais en désaccord si vous disiez ça, parce que ce sont par des actions concrètes comme celle-là qui concernent le quotidien des consommateurs et donc des citoyens que nous serons dans une prise de conscience générale, globale, que contre le gaspillage alimentaire, il faut agir sur tous les niveaux. Il faut surtout aider le consommateur à être beaucoup plus responsable vis-à-vis de son alimentation. Alors, je veux maintenant, en quelques mots, vous me dites, Samuel, si ça convient. Si
oui, alors, ben, encore 5 minutes, Guillaume, parce que ce que je vais proposer ensuite, c'est un summary. I will suggest a short summary of what Guillaume Garot said. So, please be patient for non-French-speaking people.
Je me dépêche. Hurry. Bon. J'ai fait une loi en 2016 pour poser un cadre en France d'action publique contre le gaspillage alimentaire. Avec une idée toute simple, le principe, c'est qu'on ne jette pas de la nourriture consommable. Ça, c'est le principe qui a fondé la loi que j'ai fait voter à l'unanimité en France. Et donc, elle interdit donc aux grandes surfaces de distribution, les grandes enseignes, de jeter de la nourriture consommable. Et elle fait cette loi obligation aux grandes surfaces de donner leurs invendus alimentaires aux associations de solidarité. Hein? Donner plutôt que jeter. Tout simple. Principe tout simple. Avec l'obligation de signer une convention, donc contractualisation, entre la grande surface et l'association de solidarité à proximité. Alors, 4 ans après, cette loi a été votée en 2016, les résultats sont positifs parce que les dons des grandes surfaces aux associations de solidarité ont augmenté et de façon considérable. On est à 24-25% de dons en plus depuis le vote de la loi parce que cette obligation, eh bien, elle a généré évidemment une augmentation des dons. La deuxième chose qu'a faite la loi, au-delà de ce principe de ne pas jeter, c'est qu'elle a établi une hiérarchie des actions contre le gaspillage alimentaire, en tout cas des grands principes d'action contre le gaspillage alimentaire, en disant, un, le premier principe, c'est de prévenir la formation d'excédents ou d'invendus, donc évitons de produire des invendus, évitons de produire des excédents. Deux, si c'est des excédents ou ces invendus existent, eh bien, il faut être dans le don alimentaire donc pour les humains. Troisième action, troisième priorité, si il reste des invendus et des excédents alors qu'on a organisé ces circuits de dons, eh bien, soyons sur l'alimentation animale, une autre donc valorisation. Et puis enfin, dernière chose, s'il reste encore des invendus et des excédents, il faut que ça puisse être utilisé, quatrième priorité, pour d'autres valorisations énergétiques en particulier. On pense à la méthanisation, on composte, bref, qu'on soit vraiment dans une économie circulaire. Ça a plutôt bien marché également dans l'organisation des politiques publiques locales en particulier. Mais pour terminer, parce que le temps est compté et Samuel surveille mon temps de parole, il y a deux choses que je voudrais dire. Cette loi, elle est efficace, mais elle ne sera véritablement efficace que s'il y a localement, c'est-à-dire sur les territoires, une volonté politique de mettre ensemble, d'organiser ensemble, de faire travailler ensemble les acteurs locaux, c'est-à-dire les élus locaux, les producteurs agricoles locaux, les transformateurs agroalimentaires, les associations de solidarité, les représentants des écoles, tous les acteurs locaux qui ont une responsabilité contre le gaspillage alimentaire. Tout le monde. Mais il faut mettre tout le monde ensemble localement. Et la deuxième chose que je voulais dire avant de terminer, c'est que rien ne sera durable si on n'est pas dans une réelle éducation à l'alimentation. C'est indispensable. Et donc, je me bats en ce moment, en France, pour que l'éducation à l'alimentation, et donc à la lutte contre le gaspillage alimentaire, soit retenue dans les programmes scolaires. Moi, je souhaite que ce soit sur le temps de l'école, et pas laisser simplement à la responsabilité, à la liberté des familles, des collectivités ou des associations. Que ce soit sur le temps de l'école, que ce soit un enseignement pour chaque petit Français. Ça me paraît indispensable pour qu'on puisse vraiment être dans une culture de la lutte contre le gaspillage alimentaire et du respect de l'alimentation.
Okay.
Voilà ce que je voulais dire, Samuel. Je m'arrête là. J'espère
Thank
que j'étais
you.
Pas...
Thank you very much, Guillaume. I will...
Sorry for my French.
I will make a short summary for all the participants. So, Mr. Garot said following points. First, it's a very good news that food waste become a policy objective at European level first. Secondly, it's important to harmonize the different policy intervention, national policy intervention between
yes.
member states. It's key. Third, measurement and the assessment of the quantity of food waste is essential also, because otherwise we cannot set a specific quantified object and targets in time. Fourth, it's very important as well that EU member states observe the different policy objectives set by the European Union, because it's not so obvious. Fifth, it's very important to mainstream the good practices that we have between different member states and regions. So cross-pollination, it's important. Mr. Garot has reminded that prior to its French Act Against Food Waste, he has the chance to visit Germany, to visit the UK, etc., in order to collect good idea and good practices. And in that respect, he believes it's important to have a kind of European resources center, such a hub that could run in a permanent manner. Next point, he opened a bracket regarding the best before date. Best before date on food products is a key lever for consumers, especially for specific food products like dry products. Mr. Garot suggested to extend a list of dried products don't have any best before date, like sugar yes. or salt, etc. So he suggests to extend this list at European level. This is not a small lever, according to him. And then finally, a short feedback regarding the law, the French law. When he proposed the Garot law, we said in France, in 4 years ago, which has been voted at a very large unanimity. The objectives of the law were to set as a principle, do not throw away food, edible food. It's very important. So at supermarket level, it's forbidden to throw edible food. Each supermarket shall donate unsold food to charities instead through a convention, through a contract. At the end today, 4 years later, this Garot law has enabled to rise the quantity of food donation by 25%. It's quite a lot. And then the law has established a food waste hierarchy. At the top of the hierarchy, first to act in order to prevent the generation to prevent food waste and to prevent to have unsold food product. Secondly, if we have unsold product in food in supermarket, so to distribute that through donation to charities. Then, if it's not possible to reuse unsold food surpluses for feed, and finally for energy. So this hierarchy worked well, but he concludes that this kind of national act, if it's needed, it's very important at the same time to act at local and regional level, so to facilitate the various stakeholders, including the local policymakers, the food producers, the food makers, the charities, the consumers, to work together in this, in its implementation. And in conclusion, the key is the education to food in order to prevent food waste. And education food starts at school in schools programs. So that's it. Sorry if I've been a bit long, but this was the essential message from Mr. Garot from France. Maybe we...
Congrats for your summary, dear Samuel.
You're welcome. Maybe we have some, maybe Q&A for a moment, or from reaction, some reactions from the other panelists, maybe. Mm-hmm. From Catalonia, Mr. Toast, maybe.
Sorry. Yes. Sorry. For us, the Italian and the French laws are a pioneer in Europe. It's a good reference for us. But we assume the same spirit due to collaboration for the different members of the chain, the farmers, the industry, the citizens, the private sector. The key is have a same road, the same path with collaboration. This is very important. The education is key. The people lost the values of the food, and they change the habits, they change the mentality is very important. But we have a little difference with the Catalan from the French law. In Catalonia, our law prioritizes the prevention at the source, in the camp, in the field. And against respect the French or Italian law, who work more strong, respect the redistribution of surpluses. But for us, it's very important this law to open a new legislation around the world. And for conclusion, congrats, félicitations à la France pour son law.
Thank you, Mr. Toast. Other reactions from the panelists' side?
We have a...
Yeah, Yen, please.
So yeah, no, I agree with, it's a great example. I mean, our approach slightly different in Scotland. We have a regulation for all businesses who produce food to start with recycling of it. They're not allowed to throw it out in the general waste. And that has allowed that engagement because they now measure, you know, they're now encouraged to measure their waste. And it is the old adage, I remember, when I started, you know, getting people to measure energy, you know, starting to, you know, the whole thing, if you don't measure something, you can't manage it, you can't reduce it. And I think anything, you know, anything that actually, whether they have to fill a form in or report weekly or nationally, any business that now has to identify food waste, record it, and, you know, report it, allows them then to start taking action. So I think, you know, all of that, I think it's the change that we're now seeing, whether it's in retail, supermarkets, whether it's in the hospitality industry, whether it's in the food and drink industry in terms of production, and on the farm, it's a loss that they are now very much aware of, and the economic loss as well as the climatic loss as well. And I think all of that, yes, the education in terms of the awareness of food waste, but allowing individual businesses now to measure that and identify it. You know, our hospitality industry loses, you know, something like 200 million euros a year, 200 million euros a year annually on food waste, waste that is bought by the industry and, you know, never eaten by their customers. So it's significant, you know, in terms of the impact in terms of individual businesses. So yeah, it's inspiring. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you, Yen. If there is no extra reaction from the panelists, because the time is running, so we are 5 minutes to the end. I would suggest to read a question from the participants. It's a written question, because but we don't have so much time to answer directly for Guillaume Garot. So this French experience is very indeed important. But in some countries, like in Germany, so there is this question. For food donation, how do you manage? Is there any procedure which includes the feasibility of redistribution with respect to sustainability? First part of the question. And the other part of the question is, especially for supermarkets located in rural areas, which can produce a small amount of food waste, does it make sense to redistribute that food on a daily basis, and are they exemption to that? And second part of the question is, in German-speaking countries, there is too much surplus bread for redistribution to people in need, so it makes no sense to collect and to redistribute according to the food waste hierarchy, you know. So I suggest Guillaume Garot could answer later on to that question by written form, and because we have no time left, except I come back to Jean-Paul Pélissier. Jean-Paul is the timekeeper. Jean-Paul? No, it doesn't work. Okay, fine.
It's the question of the adaptation of the of a general law to the reality of its territory, and how we can manage. If we say we have to redistribute the food, in fact, in sometimes it would be not possible. Not possible because of the surplus can be used, or because it's not sustainable to redistribute not so much food. And it's the question on how we can manage a general law regarding the specificity of some territories. And in my opinion, this also raise the question of the role of the local authorities. I don't know how they our panelists work with such reality. They live in their territories.
So, no, thank you, Jean-Paul. So you forward this question to the panelists. Thank you. How to deal at regional, at local and regional level, how to cope indeed with a national regulation against food waste, given that territories have their own specificity? Indeed, it's a key question. Maybe it's a good question for our next EU program or EU project. Who wants to answer that question? But Jean-Paul, it's in your hand now for the timekeeping. So we can continue the chat. Yeah.
I think it will be the last
question.
Yes.
So who wants to answer that question within panelists? Or Guillaume Garot in French, and I can try to translate. How to articulate both national mandatory regulation to prohibit food waste with a particular territorial specificity. This is the case of bread, for instance. Question du pain.
Et en français, tu avais dit, et tu la poses en anglais. L'idée est sur la base d'une réglementation générale. En fait, on peut s'apercevoir qu'au niveau local, son application est difficile, voire impossible. Et les deux exemples qui sont donnés dans la question, c'est l'exemple du pain en Allemagne, où en fait, il y a un tel surplus de pain que les associations caritatives n'en veulent pas, elles en ont trop. Donc, il est impossible de le distribuer sur le site. santé, ou l'autre exemple peut être de magasins dont les quantités de surplus sont trop faibles pour qu'elles puissent être distribuées de manière économique, si on peut dire les choses comme ça, de manière rentable, soutenable, et que ça coûterait plus cher de les distribuer que d'en faire autre chose. Et c'est toute la question de comment on peut gérer ces spécificités locales par rapport à une loi générale.
I will translate afterwards. Guillaume Garot.
Oui, c'est, j'entends très bien l'exemple allemand avec ces invendus de pain qui sont trop importants pour être accueillis et redistribués ensuite vers ceux qui en ont besoin. Donc la première question qu'on doit se poser, c'est pourquoi il y a autant de pain produit ? Ben, il faut quand même remettre les questions dans l'ordre. Donc la réponse qu'on avait faite en France, c'est que on doit d'abord travailler sur les besoins qu'on a et la limitation, la prévention des surplus. Alors, ce n'est pas toujours possible, selon les productions en particulier, mais il est possible que sur le pain, qui est un produit transformé, on puisse travailler là-dessus. Bon, ça, c'est quelque chose à voir à la fois avec les opérateurs agroalimentaires et avec les acteurs publics. Ensuite, la deuxième chose, c'est les petites quantités, les petits gisements pour le don alimentaire. Eh bien, voyez-vous, il y a là en France d'autres solutions qui ont été inventées, qui sont vraiment des solutions d'ultra-proximité, en tout cas en milieu urbain. Hein, je l'ai vu à Paris, avec des initiatives très intéressantes par des associations qui justement se sont spécialisées sur ces petites quantités, avec un réseau alors, et de professionnels et de bénévoles, c'est vrai, hein, ça échappe à la loi du marché, hein, mais qui permet justement de limiter le gaspillage et en même temps d'être dans la lutte contre la précarité alimentaire. J'ajoute enfin qu'il y a des solutions sur les petites quantités qui permettent de lutter contre le gaspillage avec des applications. Aujourd'hui, le développement du numérique est un outil, un vrai levier. Je pense à une application que beaucoup d'Européens connaissent qui s'appelle Too Good To Go. Et on est aussi sur ces petites quantités, alors là, qui ne sont pas données, mais qui sont vendues à bas prix en fin de journée et qui permettent de rendre à la fois de lutter contre le gaspillage et de rendre un vrai service social parce que vous avez un panier qui coûte 3 ou 5 euros et qui va permettre de nourrir beaucoup de bouches le soir qui vient ou la journée suivante. Donc, il y a des solutions, il y a des adaptations possibles, mais là encore, alors, il faut organiser les acteurs. C'est pour ça que je crois beaucoup à toutes les initiatives et toutes les organisations locales. Ça me paraît une des clés de la réussite.
Thank you, Guillaume, for your answer. So, in English, regarding this twofold question, first, regarding the unsold bread, the question is, why do we produce so much bread in specific territories? So, it's important to work first on our own food needs regarding bread with bakeries, with bakers, basically. First question. This is something we had the chance to visit in Italy in Ferrara two years ago with Michele Pancaldi within the EcoWaste for Food project. And regarding the second dimension of the question, regarding the small quantities, the experience shows in France, for instance, that we can find solutions even with dealing with small quantities. We have specific small associations, organizations, and networks that can organize, that can deal the logistics of the redistribution of unsold food. Mr. Garot gave the example of the very famous digital application named Too Good To Go in France, but it exists also in other countries. This is something we have visited in extra countries through another name, like Rescue Club. So such digital application demonstrates that it's possible to deal with small quantities of unsold food and to distribute them at the end of the day with discount prices for people in need. So that's it. Thank you, Guillaume Garou, for your answer. I give the floor now to Jean-Paul for the conclusive session, for the conclusions. Thank you to all the panelists for their very active participation in such panel. And thank you again and good luck for your next engagement at local or regional level against food waste. Thank you.